बिस्मिल्लाहिर्रहमानिर्रहीम। ऑलराइट क्लास, अस्सलाम वालेकुम। वेलकम टू द थर्ड टू द सेकंड लेक्चर ऑफ द थर्ड वीक। एंड इन द लास्ट क्लास वी स्टार्टेड सिलिंड्रिकल कोऑर्डिनेट सिस्टम एंड इन दिस क्लास वी विल ट्राई टू कंप्लीट इट इंशाल्लाह। सो इन द लास्ट क्लास आई शोड यू 15 डिफरेंट डायग्राम्स एंड वी डिस्कस अबाउट फंडामेंटल surfaces and the shapes and the lines and the circles and all. I'm not going to repeat that all. I'm just going to repeat the last two figures that we were discussing, in which we had the three dimensional views of all the three fundamental surfaces: rho equals to constant, phi equals to constant radial plane, and z equals to constant. And we took these example values. So this is nothing but 60 degrees measured with respect to the reference axis, which is x-axis. And then we showed the last diagram. If we see this diagram from the top, what we'll see, this circle, which is actually phi is equals to constant surface in three dimension, two dimension it is a circle. So we were discussing at the very end, we were discussing the unit vectors. And the thing I wanted to share with you is just to show you with clear picture what the unit vector is. So a rho is the unit vector which should be perpendicular to rho equals constant surface, is it? So if it is so, then this is in two dimensions. This is, you know, rho equals to constant, green surface, that is a circle. And if I draw the if I try to draw this unit vector, it should be perpendicular to rho. Not only that, but it should always point in the direction of increasing values of rho. So this green marker, this green line, is showing us the, I hope you see it green, and this is nothing but a rho. Two definitions are fulfilling here. Secondly, a phi is a unit vector which is perpendicular to phi equals constant surface, and that should be pointing in the direction of increasing values of phi. So here we go. This blue line has got, no matter wherever you go on this blue line, this line is making an angle phi with respect to x-axis, that is a reference axis. So if I draw a perpendicular, I've got two options: either go in that direction or go in this direction. So we have to choose the direction in which, if we move from this point, we will have the increasing values of that coordinate. So this should be a phi. And you can see that one is the radian line, the other is perpendicular to the radian line or tangent to this surface. So if I move in this direction, in the direction of tangent, so definitely rho will not change, as it should not change, because we are defining a unit vector, primitive unit vector, in the direction of phi, in whose direction if I am moving, only phi should change, nothing else should change. Okay, so it's clear now that we have got a 90 degree angle between a rho and a phi. Secondly, both exist on the horizontal z equals constant plane. This should also be clear to you all. We have discussed that in the previous class. So if I try to draw the a rho in the green one in three dimensions, remember that this green circle is on the z equals constant plane. This line is also is on z equals constant plane. Why? Because this green was the intersection of this cylinder and z equals constant plane. So it must be on radic wall's constant plane, and this blue line is nothing but the intersection of the radial plane and this horizontal plane. So this blue line, this blue radial line, should also be on the radic wall's constant plane along with being on the radial plane. So if I'm at this point and want to know the direction in which, if I move, only rho will change. For at that point, a rho should be perpendicular to rho equals to constant. In other words, I should move in a direction which should be perpendicular to rho equals to constant. Only then, if I move in that direction, the values of rho will change, and the other two will remain constant simultaneously. So the only point, the only direction which I have is the direction along this radial plane, because we all know that in two dimensions radial line is perpendicular to the surface, in three dimensions radial planes are perpendicular to cylinders. So if I move in this direction, this is a rho. I hope you are able to see it clearly in green. And now for the phi one, this phi, a phi should be perpendicular to phi equals to constant radial plane, this radial plane. It should be perpendicular to that, and also it should be, if it is perpendicular to radial plane, so it should be tangential to the cylindrical surface, and it should point in the direction of increasing values of phi. So from this point, the direction of phi should be, the direction of a phi should be like this. A should be on the horizontal plane. It cannot be in other direction, otherwise this blue arrow, that is a phi, will not be perpendicular to the radial plane. Remember that. And az is nothing but, you know, as we defined it earlier, so this is az. So these two lines, these two unit vectors are parallel to horizontal plane, are lying on horizontal plane. So definitely this red az vector is perpendicular to both of them simultaneously. So we can say that at the point of intersection in cylindrical coordinate system, all the three unit vectors are perpendicular to each other. In other words, we can say that at every point in a three-dimensional cylindrical coordinate system, all the fundamental surfaces are perpendicular to each other. Okay, so now the other topic was the differential volume, differential surfaces, and differential length, and we will go in exactly the same way in which we went last time while we were discussing Cartesian coordinate system. So let's say we have got a point P and a point Q, and I've taken any arbitrary values. P is 350 degrees, 2, and Q is 5, 70 degrees, and 3. So you, by now you should know that this P is on a cylindrical surface whose radius or the distance with respect to z-axis is 3, and Q is on a surface, cylindrical surface, whose radius or the distance with respect to the z-axis is 5. So P is on a smaller cylinder, Q is on a larger cylinder, but both cylinders are concentric. Remember that both cylinders have got the same central axis, which is the z-axis. So this is how we define cylinders in cylindrical coordinate system, that we take the central axis of the cylinder as the z-axis. So both cylinders are sharing the same central axis. So we can say they are concentric. So okay, All right, so yeah, so point P is on some inner cylinder and point Q is on some outer cylinder. So you can see I've made this point P here with the same color coding and point Q here. All right, so whatever this catch is there, I'm sure you're not able to see it. This is only for my guidance so that I can draw properly. It is not for you to see, okay? So you should see only XYZ axis, these points and two points here. Yeah, that's it. That's it what you should see now. All right, so now if I move, what we discussed while we were discussing, you know, Cartesian coordinate system, we took a point whose coordinates were, and we took another point whose coordinates were x2, y2 and z2, and we said that x2 is nothing but slight displacement from x1, y2 is nothing but slight displacement with respect to y1, this is y1, and z2 is nothing but slight displacement, very minute displacement with respect to z1. That's it. This is what we discussed. So now what we are on the same lines, we are saying that point P, which is actually should be rho 1, phi 1 and z1, and Q is rho 2, phi 2 and z2. So rho 2 is nothing but slight displacement with respect to rho 1, and there we go, we'll be on rho 2. And if and phi 2 is slight displacement with respect to phi 1, and z2 is nothing but slight displacement with respect to z1. Okay, so if we are standing, at this point, which is point P, I am highlighting it as red. Okay, so now you should know that this point is made up of these three fundamental surfaces: some cylinder, some radial plane, and horizontal plane. I am not going to draw it, but you should know it that there is some certain cylinder whose distance, perpendicular distance should show you, meaning if I draw perpendicular from this point to this z-axis, this distance is actually rho 1, okay, or in this case it's 3. And this height, if I draw perpendicular from here to here, this height is z1, okay, and the point where this line intersects z equals 0 plane, so this point, if joined with origin, forms a line, and this line is making an angle, should make an angle phi 1. I'm just writing it here, phi 1 with respect to x axis. Okay, so what I'm trying to say here is that if I drop a perpendicular at this point, if I drop a perpendicular, okay, on z equals 0 plane or xy plane, and the point which I got from here, okay, and if I join this point to origin, and extend it, so this line should make an angle phi 1 with respect to x-axis, okay. All right, so and if I draw a perpendicular on z-axis like this, so on z-axis this point should be z1, okay, with respect to, so this height is z1. Not only that, but also, if I just try to extend it, this length, but length between this point and this point, should give us rho 1, I'm not writing it here, otherwise the diagram would be cluttered, so that won't help us. So now, from that point, what we are doing, we are now moving in the direction of, now we'll move in the direction of rho slightly. How much slight? Very slight, extremely slight. Okay, so we are already at this point, so we are already at rho 1, phi 1, z 1, or 350 or 20 if you like, 350 and 2, sorry, this is 2. And then following the same lines which we did in the Cartesian coordinate system, we said, okay, now move from this point, move in the direction of a rho. Okay, so if I join this point to origin, to z axis, which I already did, this is the, you know, radial line on this constant radial plane, just like this. Okay, and if I extend it, I am moving in the direction of a rho certain units, and I am calling that that certain unit as b rho. Ye bahut thoda sa distance maine travel kiya. Okay, now I stopped at this point. Okay, now I am on a larger cylinder. I am not on the same previous cylinder, remember that. Okay, so because I moved in that, in the direction of rho, so now the cylinder radius of the cylinder is no more the same, it should be greater, it should be like now 5. Okay, but the other two coordinates should be 50 and 2, meaning if I drop, I have reached to a new point, if I drop a perpendicular from here to here, from this point to z equals to 0 plane, now I would land on the same line, which is making an angle phi with respect to the reference axis, which is x-axis in our case. Okay, so now secondly, move in the direction of rho, how many units? D rho. Now move in the direction of phi, how many units? D phi units, D phi degrees. So now, keeping the rho constant, when I'll move while keeping the rho constant, obviously I am moving along the surface of the cylinder. If we see it from the top, if I move while keeping rho constant, the radius of the circle constant, it means I am moving along the circumference of this circle. So in three dimensions, if I am moving along the horizontal axis, not changing the values of z, okay, moving in the direction of a phi means don't change the values of z, don't change your level with respect to xy plane or z equals to 0 plane. So move, after moving, I would reach at this point, right? Rho is constant now, which is 5, which should be 5, or generally that should be rho 2. At this point, at this new point, and z should be the same because we haven't changed it. But what has changed is, if I drop a perpendicular on z equals 0 plane from this new point, I would land on a different point, on a different line. So this is the point which is the intersection of this perpendicular and the z equals 0 plane. So if I join this point with origin and extend the line, now we are on a totally different angle, which is making, I'm just emboldening it so that you could see, this is phi 2 now. So the difference between these two lines should be d phi. Still we are on the same height, same h, same value of z, sorry, not h. Now move in the direction of z, meaning move in that around this red vector. So move along this red means now we will reach along this line, we will reach to a new point which will give us this final point Q. And now we have moved to a new point. I've tried to draw it using the blue color, but I'm not sure whether you can see it or not. But now at this point, if I drop a perpendicular, obviously this perpendicular on z equals 0 plane. So it will go through this blue line and will follow this black line and will land on this, because this point is directly above this point, right? Okay, so here we go. There we go. The new point. Okay, so now if I join this point, if I drop from this point a line on perpendicular line on z-axis, so this will be rho 2 and at this point will be z2. Okay, so now we have got three surfaces to which makes this point Q as this point P, and three entirely different surfaces which make this point Q, but they all together form these all six surfaces, which are infinite, by the way. The rho equals to constant surface is an infinite surface which is infinite in length, in height, or I should say, okay, it is finite in circumference and in the radius, but it is infinite in length. Similarly, the radial plane is infinite in width and height, and similarly z equals zero constant plane is also infinite, but all these six infinite planes are actually enclosing a volume which is not infinite, which is actually finite. So what volume is that? That volume is, if I draw, you know, the equivalent arc, the same arc in green here, okay, and the same length here, the same red length here, between, you know, rho equals to 3 and rho equals to 5, or generally rho equals to rho 1 and rho equals to rho 2, and again okay, and if I now draw the difference of the height between z, this is z equals z1, this is z equals to z2 plane, so this is also z equals z1, this is z equals z2 plane, okay. And similarly, this also, z equals z2, z equals z1, is it? Similarly, z equals z2, since this is on background, I'm just making it with dotted lines. This again, this is, this blue line is the perpendicular distance between z1 and z2. That is nothing but the z2 minus z1, or delta z. In other words, I can say that this is dz, not delta z, this is dz, okay? So, if this is the height, so we have got this point, we have got this point, and now if I join, because this point and this point both are on z2 height, and this point and this point, again these two points are not only on the same z2 height, but they are also on the same radial plane. So if I just join these two, it means I, in this direction, I am only changing the value of rho. So this red line is d rho, this red line is d rho, and similarly the one which is exactly below that, and since it is on the background, I am just making it dotted, okay. right? So now, what about the point between the curve between these two points, this point and that point? If I'm at this point, I'm on z2. If I'm on this point, I'm on z2. Okay, the only thing is which is changing between these two points is the angle. If I drop a perpendicular on z equals 0 plane, I will land here. If I drop perpendicular on z equals 0 plane, I'll drop here. So the only thing which is changing is phi, meaning it should be a curve. So similarly, the one exactly below this. So I've drawn the differential volume in case of a cylindrical coordinate system. So this distance, I just draw in here, this distance is rho 1, this distance, and the total distance, meaning the distance, where should I draw it? Should I draw it here? If I go like upward like this, this direction, this distance should be rho 2. Okay. So now, removing all the extra lines, this is the shape of the differential volume. And can anyone tell me? No one can tell me, yeah. But okay, so this is the distance, no problem, distance, the distance or length of this red line is nothing but d rho. I hope you can see this red line is nothing but d rho. The height is nothing but dz. How about these green lines? These green lines. So if I just draw the projection of this on the z equals 0 plane, so this will be, an arc, is it? So the arc length of this green line will be, remember the formula, if this is the radius rho and the angle distance difference between this point and that point is d phi, okay, if this distance is rho 1 or rho 2 does not matter, if it is rho generally, rho, then length of this arc is nothing but rho into d phi. Remember that we had, a circle of radius r. If we wanted this arc length, which is s, and this angle between these two lines is theta, so s was equals to r theta, radius times the angle between the two lines. Okay, so the angle between the two lines is d phi. So this arc length is nothing but, and the radius is rho, so it is nothing but rho d phi. So now you can tell me the formula for differential volume. The volume is nothing but height, width, length, all multiplied all together. So this is dz, okay, dz, blue lines dz, green line rho d phi, we just discovered rho d phi, okay, dz rho d phi, dz rho d phi. How about this? This is d rho, d rho. So it is customary, it is convention to write all the variables of rows first, all the rho first, then phi, then z. So the formula for differential volume becomes rho d phi dz. Okay, so now the formula for differential surfaces. Let's say for the surface over which the rho is constant. Now we have got, for sure we have got six surfaces. One surface is on the outer cylinder, this one, made by two green curves and two blue curves, the outer cylinder one, okay. And we have got similar differential length on the inner cylinder made by two green curves and two blue curves. Both should have the same formula. Depending upon the value of rho, this arc length will change, okay, but the formula should not contain rho 1 or rho 2, because rho 1 and rho 2 are arbitrary values. We should write a formula in terms of variables, and we will let the, you know, mathematics decide what we should put. Should we put rho 1 or rho 2, phi 1 or phi 2? So we should keep the formula in the general sense. All right, sorry for being absent-minded right now. Anyway, so if I should write the formula for differential surface at which the value of rho is constant, meaning the ones which are being formed by blue lines and the green lines, in that case, what we should have dz multiplied by rho d phi. So it is customary to write rho first. Rho d phi dz should be the formula for the surface, differential surface, over which the value of phi, value of rho is constant. So as we all know that differential patches or differential surfaces are vector quantities, so we should have an appropriate unit vector associated with that. And what that should be in the case of Cartesian coordinate system, remember, you should have remembered dsx had a unit vector ax, because that unit vector, the direction of a differential surface is always perpendicular to that surface. And since we have said that over this patch, blue and green patch, over this patch the value of rho is constant, so it means the perpendicular to this patch should be a unit vector a rho. Similarly, now for the differential length, I should write it here, differential surface for which the value of phi is constant. Value of phi is constant for the surface made by these vertical lines, blue lines, and these horizontal red lines, okay. If I drop perpendicular on z equals 0 plane from this point or that point, it will land on the same line which is making an angle phi 1. Or if I drop a perpendicular from this point or this point, it will land on the same line. So this side surface is the surface over which phi is constant. So the formula should be d rho, red one, d rho and dz, d rho and dz, height multiplied by width. And this should be multiplied by, because for the radial plane, the vector which is perpendicular, unit vector which is perpendicular, is a phi. And similarly for the surface, differential surface over which the value of z is constant, is the top one, the one which is made by red lines and this green curve, okay, over which the z is constant, okay. So this should be the formula for this green line. We already discovered is rho d phi, okay, and the formula for this length is the red one is d rho. So the unit vector associated with that is this one, okay. So we have got differential volume, differential surfaces. So I just wrote this one here, and two here. Okay, so I hope you should be able to see it. Okay, now differential length, the length which starts from this point P and terminates at point Q. Okay, what should that be? That differential length, should I say, that is actually the address to reach point Q starting from point P. How did we reach point Q starting from point P? We said that move in the direction of arrow, how many units? 0 units. Then move in the direction of A phi, how many units? We should give arc length here, we should not give d phi only, we should not give angle here, we should give arc length here. And then move in the direction of z, how many units? Dz units. Now this is the formula for differential length in the case of cylindrical coordinate system. Always remember, don't put d phi here, because this is differential length, it should end up in the units of meters. Okay, so meter plus meter plus meter ends up in meter. You cannot do this. Meter plus radians plus meter can never end up in meter. So to make things consistent, we should convert d phi into the arc length. All right, so that's it. Okay, we have discussed differential volume, differential surfaces, and differential length. Okay, now so one more point which I should mention here, because students sometimes they make blunder. Whenever you use d phi to calculate the arc length, always put this d phi in radians, never put it in degrees. Okay, that's a must. Remember that whenever in any equation angle is there without any function like sine, cos, theta, or sine theta, or tangent theta, or cot theta, if it is, as a general rule, if it is coming alone without any function, trigonometric function, then you must put that angle in radians. Remember that. All right, the final point or the second last point which I should mention here, that about cylindrical coordinate system, that if you are given with a point, let's say point P here. Okay, now I'm messing up with this the final diagram to make the point which to discuss the formula which I have given here. So if we have been given a point in cylindrical coordinate system and we want to find its equivalent Cartesian coordinate system, or vice versa, it is possible. How the formulas are given there, how, but let's discuss. Let's say this point is the point P whose coordinates are rho, phi, and z. It means that if I drop a perpendicular from this point to origin, to z equals 0 plane, this would end up on this line, and this height is nothing but z. Okay, and if I join this point to origin, so this length is nothing but rho. Okay, this length is nothing but rho, and the angle which this line is making with respect to x-axis is phi. Okay, so what I can do, instead of reaching this point from origin using the cylindrical coordinate system, move in the direction of reference axis, how many units? Rho units, and move in the direction of phi, how many units, so and so, and then move in the direction of z. I don't want to move in that fashion. I want to move in the fashion which I am more used to of, meaning I want to use the rectangular coordinate system, Cartesian coordinate system. So what I can do, I got this point, and if I draw a parallel line parallel to x-axis, which would definitely intersect on y-axis, and if I draw from the same point a parallel on y, which would definitely reach, you know, x-axis. So now I've got this length. This length is nothing but x, and this length is nothing but y. Okay, so I can say I can reach this point using the Cartesian coordinate system. Move in the direction of x, how many units? X units. Now move in the direction of y, how many units? Y units. Now move in the direction of z, how many units? Z units. Okay, so we know that this line was what? This line was rho. This line is x. This angle was phi. Okay, I already wrote it here, phi. Okay, I hope you are able to see it, phi. So now x is nothing but, now this is a right angle triangle, okay, because we drop perpendicular here, so this is 90 degrees with respect to, we draw parallel to x-axis, which would intersect y, parallel to y-axis, which would intersect x-axis perpendicularly. So we have got the theorem of Pythagorean theorem. X should be equals to rho cos of phi. Y should be equal to rho sine phi, and z is nothing but the same. So, and vice versa is also true. If we are given with x, y, and z, we can calculate rho using the Pythagorean theorem, and then also the phi is nothing but tangent inverse of perpendicular upon base, and z equals to z. So that's it for today, and definitely. Inshallah, the next two lectures would be on a spherical coordinate system. So you can imagine the amount of time which I am spending on this to make your concepts clear is too much, only because at the later stage when we'll start electrostatics and magnetostatics, inshallah, I will just write things straightforward with no explanation whatsoever. So you should be very well versed in all these concepts, that which point lies on which surface, and if I am moving in a particular direction, which coordinates are changing and which coordinates are not changing. You must be well versed in all these things. So I am giving a great deal of time in this, more than what I anticipated. Mathematics will take only, you know, about 2 weeks, but it is taking more than 2 weeks. So you must be very well prepared, you know, must be fluent and have everything on your fingertips, and that would only be possible if you do all the end of chapter problems, go through, you know, take your brain through gym, by solving these problems which I gave you already, assigned you. I have already shared that with you on the Google Classroom platform. So please do it. Otherwise, all this time would not be that useful, and we will be compromising on the other electromagnetics, the actual electromagnetic stuff. But the reason to discuss all this is that mathematics beautifully defined electromagnetics. With this, I would say good luck and assalamu alaikum.